special mentor as I worked in his office for 5 years, which was a very special experience. So the disclosure is there is a relevant financial relationship. The Voice Foundation partially supports my participation at this symposium. Singers and actors have been practicing their craft for centuries, long before teachers ever taught a lesson. So the pedagogy issue is, this is a definition. The method and practice of teaching, especially as an academic subject or theoretical concept. So we're going to go along this line and try to define things clearly and acceptable to all aspects of academic work. So the history of pedagogy, we have a comparative literature in piano pedagogy, violin, band, orchestra, chorus, etc. that seems to be analytical. And it seems to want to compare pedagogical ideas across all teaching modalities. And there is a general understanding in most of these pedagogies about what pedagogy is. However, for some reason, in the vocal world, we have a lot of people that are very territorial about their pedagogy, and they want to talk about their lineage, who taught them, and where did they come from. And I could do that, but I think that it's more important to talk about the student and how we can make the student a better performer. So as we are looking at what our duties are as pedagogues and what our duties are to our students, we need to be looking at the names that are used for some of us. When you watch television, they're always using terms like coaches and teachers, and they're poorly defined, and there's no regulation of using it. Non-musicians tend to use things like, we want to find the best coach for our child, and I study voice on the internet. So in a thumbnail, we have some ancient pedagogical stories in the literature. We know that the Emperor Nero studied voice. And he took singing lessons with many, many singing teachers that all were employees of the imperial court. And they would stack books and blocks and things on his abdomen to improve his support. However, we began to see a lot of treatises around the 16th century. And these were some about just singing, and some of them were about just music and how to perform music. But along about the 1590s, we began to see in Italy this idea of monody. Monody is solo song, and the first artful songs were written about that time by such guys as Caccini and Monteverdi. And with the beginning of monody, we began to talk about, well, you've got to do it just this way, or just so. And so Caccini gave us a nice little treatise on performance practice, which is really nice. We can look at and see exactly what he wanted if we all understood the words that he used, which we don't always do. So, but during that time, in the early 16th century, there are many essays regarding performances of specific pieces and the performances of specific styles as they began to evolve. And these authors were not the teachers of famous singers. They were typically the teachers and musicians that were employed by the royal courts of Europe. And so these were famous because of who they knew and not who they taught. So we have a lot of things, books of exercises. We've got lots and lots and lots of exercises. And so in the 19th century in the conservatories, we began to see lots of books of exercises, which were updated practically every year. And many teachers made more in their own little bookshops than they did teaching lessons. So as we look at some of these, we come across a couple of really important ones. Now those of you that are physicians in this room will know Manuel Garcia as the inventor of the laryngoscope. He was also a singing teacher. He was the son of Manuel Garcia I, but he became very famous because he taught many famous singers, including his two sisters, Pauline Viardot and Malibran. But Garcia would sell his books in Paris, and they were in French or in Italian, and there are a few translations into English, but he was the first to start talking about anatomy. He would look inside and he saw the human larynx. This picture shows him looking at his own human larynx, and this was a new thing. Really understanding anatomic variability was the beginning of what I would like to call modern vocal pedagogy. And he began to look at some of the same things we see now, things like body type. Tom Hickson talked a lot about ectomorph, mesomorph, and endomorph. And most pedagogues today really acknowledge the skull size, the size of the larynx, and the physical height of the specimen are really important issues. So in the early 20th century, we began to see a lot of published books. That was a new thing. the 19th century, there were not a lot of books published, some, yes, but everybody was writing a little book or a little pamphlet. And most homes at that time, this is before radio or television, had a musical instrument, whether it's a violin or a guitar or a piano, and singers, famous singers, were very highly regarded. Many teachers, many performers, many professors began to hang out their shingles. When you look at New York's history, the borough of Brooklyn was all about singing teachers. In the 20th century, we also had an explosion of speech science. And when we look at Seashore's work in the 1930s, numerous authors in Europe. Of course, the success of all of these had to do with the great researchers that were good at publishing things and writing in a way that was clear and easy to understand. Bartholomew, Victor Alexander Fields, look up that wonderful bibliography of vocal pedagogy that he wrote in the 40s, and others. So in the 60s, we began to see a monumental change. Vocal pedagogy began to be the domain that physicians would need to understand, and scientists would need to understand, and speech scientists, voice scientists, physicians, and even singing teachers began to collaborate in laboratories. So when we look at Vinard in his wonderful book, The Mechanism and the Technique, the work of Gunnar Fund, we began seeing these pedagogues, these speech scientists, working in teams. Specifically, the Los Angeles team of Hans von Leyden was employing Vinard as a singing teacher. He was employing Hirano to be working in his laboratory. And that was a great model that eventually began echoing throughout the world. We began to see similar teams in all the great laboratories of the world. So in the 1960s, we suddenly saw a change of writing style. It was no longer the popular how I do it kind of writing. It began to be much more scientifically oriented, and cause and effect began to be the important thing. So as we look at the cause and effect issues of teaching, we also need to look at how we apply these teaching ideas. And so there is overlap among various areas, and we now have licensure and specialization in some of these areas. Not in the teaching of singing, but definitely in speech, and definitely in medicine. So this is the Voice Foundation, so we do need to be talking about voices. There we go, I'll take my little pointer. So let's see what we can do here.
I had a dream about you, baby. It's gonna come true, baby. They think that we're through, but baby.
All of you recognize the voice of Ethel Merman. But many people come to my studio, parents bring their children in, my daughter sounds just like Ethel Merman. But people don't always listen clearly and carefully. As we listen to these samples, I want you to be listening to things like vocal variety. When we look at vocal variety in the human voice, we need to look at changes of pitch, changes of loudness, changes of the rate of delivery, whether it's in speech or in singing, and of course, the use of pauses. So as we listen on, we're going to hear some pauses.
You!
What did we just hear? We heard attack, diminish, slide. So those are two of the aspects of what I just gave you as range of motion elements. Now these are in every speech textbook. You looked at the idea of vocal prosody in your speech science textbooks. We need to apply that in vocal pedagogy as well. So what happened? There we go. Did we lose our screen? There we go, okay. So as we look at this example again, we'll listen, and I want you to listen to change of loudness, change of pitch, change of rate, and the use of pauses.
I had a dream about you, baby. It's gonna come true, baby. They think that we're through, but baby.
Sound please. first played this for George Shirley, our colleague who often attends here, he, in that long, long, long last note, he began to look at his wristwatch. But that's worth listening to. And I want you to listen to one of my students. She made this recording when she was about 19 years old, but she uses a lot of vocal variety. Tapering those phrases, those are not things that happen accidentally. Those are the things that are the result of good pedagogical ideas and adhering to those ideas of vocal variety in those four elements. So just so that everyone knows, these are the ranges that we're talking about for choral voices and for operatic voices. And if you can see the frequencies down below, that tells us what our frequencies are, and we also use them, the numbering systems of the octaves based on A at the bottom of the piano is A0, the first C becomes C1, and by octaves we add the numbers as they go on up. So as we continue this, we need to talk about what is technique and what is style. And that needs to become the domain of pedagogues in the 21st century. We have many misconceptions. Many people still think that you've got to specialize in one genre. You've got to be a teacher that just teaches hip-hop, or just teaches opera only, or just teaches choral music. But I think that if you understand anatomy and physiology, and you begin to work from a perception of really what exercise physiology can teach us in pedagogy, we can begin to look at the voice as a voice and not just a style of singing. So when we look at even in the classical world, we see the difference between bel canto and canto declamato. Even in the 18th century, bel canto was the style of Italian singing that had much florid writing, accentuations and diminishes. In France, they began to use a model of chant déclamé, where the patter of the language is what made the sound the way it was. So when you have a song like Viens sur vos cages, belle amante, sans contrainte, on dit comme des vœux, it has a patter to the language that gives us that declamation. It's not making it laryngeally dangerous, but it is a different stylistic element that makes it very different from Notice the crescendos and diminuendos that are dominant in that bel canto style. So style and technical elements will emerge from these uses of the voice. So, technique and style. We have to take into consideration performance practice. What's performance practice? That's the rules that are written or maybe unwritten. But performance practice for Broadway is changing dramatically these days. Performance practice for the opera stage is changing dramatically these days. And so as time marches on, we have to learn how to make our performance practice fit the needs of our clients. As we go on, what is quality? There are things that we have to be aware of in the medical world. What's a glottic sound? What's a supraglottic sound? If we have put too much strain on the glottal area, we're going to have damage. If we can learn how to use things that are supraglottic, what would that be? All those things that happen above the vocal folds can be really great for performers to know. Noise is part of the way we perform. And so understanding and mastering consonants and other noises are going to give us more control over our instruments. So in our current times, what singers need teachers? How long do singers need to study? So Omori, back in the 90s, found in his paper about the singing power ratio that after 4 years of training, significant increase in acoustic power was found. And everybody wants power, right? But different genres want more than just power, and different genres have different needs. So you're going to see a difference between classical and pop singers, how long they need to study. Jazz singers, some of them don't study at all. In the world of country, some of them only take a lesson if they've got a problem. So singer-songwriters are beginning to study much more than they used to. Rappers, well, you think, how many rappers are there in this world? A few of them do come in and take lessons. And of course, cantors have a very special need, whether they're Catholics or Orthodox or Jewish. So the religious use of the voice is something that we need to begin to address also in pedagogy. So looking at our techniques, one of the things we have to conquer The control of pitch is kind of like the Holy Grail. If you don't control pitch, you're going to be having a problem. And I do see people who are in mid-career that begin to have pitch problems. And so they need to come to their teachers or find a new teacher, go back for training, and sometimes train for as much as 6 months or a year to get control of pitch again. So many people are looking at loud, loud, loud. The control of loudness and dynamic variety is one of the most important things. If you don't have dynamic variety, you're going to be either not singing, you're going to be singing far too hard, and you're going to be in the doctor's office. The structures of phrasing, these are the rules of performance practice. Flexibility, if you can't sing with flexibility, you're going to be inflexible, and that's going to give you a lack of range of motion, and your physical strength will fail very soon. So as we begin to look at age considerations, adults have specific needs. We need to look at these critical features, resonance and vocal flexibility. But children, do children need to study? When I was a younger teacher, I thought that, well, it was not appropriate to send these children to learn arias when they're 5 and 6 years old. And so I would try to deflect them to study violin and piano and other things. But nowadays, I see lots of children that are working professionally on the Broadway theaters and even in community theaters around the country. And they need to have good teachers. Maybe not for an hour lesson every single week, but they need to have good teaching and enlightened pedagogues. So as we look at these things, musicality and flexibility are very important issues. So we need to be looking at how the musical demands of the style are going to affect the pedagogical approach. Looking at what we are as pedagogues, we're essentially exercise physiologists. We are the people that are going to be able to look at how the athlete as singer begins to become better and better. And everybody knows that if you're going to go to the Olympics, you can't get there without a trainer, because talent is never enough. So as we look at the jargon, I gave everyone a nice little handout here. The jargon that doctors like to use sometimes scares the singers. And so I've got some more singer-friendly terms on the backside for doctors to start using. These are actually Dr. Gould's ideas, because he didn't want people to be afraid. He used to see people coming in who said, "Doctor, it's not nodules, is it?" But nodules are not as terrible as other things that they might have. And so he began to just call them calluses. And of course, instead of operating on them, he'd send them to a really good speech pathologist. But on side A, these terms that singers and music students use all the time, many doctors and speech pathologists are not really comfortably aware of. So look over your glossary and take a voice lesson and find out what all these words mean. So as we look at these other terms, we need to look at terms that are not really well defined. We see so many different definitions of the term chest voice. We see so many different definitions of the term head voice. Even the word falsetto has about 7 or 8 different definitions. And what is a bell besides what I have in my pants right now? So these things are sometimes confusing, and we need to begin to understand ways of speaking in understandable scientific ways. So as we look at these, we have athletic requirements. We have ways of looking and comparing these. Let's see if we can get this thing going.
How do you know when you know it well enough? When you can do it predictably, pretty well, you know it well enough to present.
At what point you give it up to the emotion? You always go to why the person is singing it in the first place.
It's like a pole vaulter. You know, you feel the pole in your hands, you know where the box is, you know exactly how many steps it's going to be, you plant the pole in the box, you flex the pole, you bend it, and you pop it over. It's the same thing with singing a song or an aria.
And thank you to PBS for providing us with the footage. Now, we do listen to the people that come to these conferences, and when they give us feedback, we try to give them what they want. And last year we got a lot of requests for a glossary, and so you have a glossary from Dr. Sadaloff, and you have a glossary from me. Please take those home and learn from them, study from them, and keep asking questions. But also, there were a lot of requests of people who want to know how we do it. And I'm a very humble person, and I don't like to brag about what I do so much, but it was suggested that we have a miniature lesson today. So is there a volunteer that would like to have a quick and easy voice lesson? Somebody? This young lady right over here wants a voice lesson. So I'm just going to speak loudly. So I want to just give you the quick and easy way of simplifying my approach to voice, and I'm hoping most of you will agree with the things that I look at. In an initial session, you never know what the person is going to bring to you. Sometimes they'll tell you what they want from you, sometimes they don't really know what they want from you, and so sometimes the things that they tell you aren't necessarily true, so we have to figure out some things. So some of the things that I do in the first session for someone that comes in is I try to find out what their vocal range is, and so I ask them, what's your vocal range? She says G3 to G5.
Can
we use this?
Yes. Yeah, it's all good.
Okay, she says that her range is from G3 to G5. So she knows, which is nice to see, because so many people will come in and they don't read music, or they don't know what their range is. Or they'll come in and they say, well, my choir teacher says I'm alto, or I'm soprano. And they don't really know what their range is. And when they have to go to the arranger to have an arrangement made, they don't know what to tell the arranger, because the arranger needs to know what's the lowest good sounding tone and what's the highest good sounding tone and how many of those can they sing in a single song. So as we begin to look at these things, we need to know. And so typically I will go to the piano and I will test the range to see what the lowest good sounding tone is and see what the highest good sounding tone is. And I'm pretty good at tricking them to let go of their inhibitions and really finding out what their range is. But the things that we need to begin to look at then, once we know what the range is, we need to look at what are the attributes of the voice. And typically when someone comes in, they're very afraid of the teacher. And so their posture is always this timid thing. And this young lady is very brave, and she has pretty darn good posture. But I'm going to tell all of you what I look for in the four elements that I look for in vocal pedagogy. So I have a four-point checklist. Number one is respiration. And posture is the beginning of the key to respiration. Number two is the bright ringing resonance of the voice. And we have exercises that we use to find that brighter ringing resonance. Number three is that lofty yawning space that we need, because that protects our voice from injuries. And number four, we must avoid excessive unnecessary tension or strain or pain. So that's my four-point checklist. Let's start with number one. So, for the posture, I believe that the shoulder blades are the key to good posture. What do we want to find in posture? We want to find an absence of clavicular breathing. We want to find a good width to the ribcage, so the diaphragm has a great foundation. If you build a house without a good foundation, you don't have a very strong house. So the width of the lower ribs is very important, and the clavicular movement should be gone. If someone is constantly caving in, and expanding, that has to be eliminated. So we're going to do a little bit of an exercise. Stand right over here. I want you to stand like this. Arms out, palms up, elbows bent. Make sure your knees are loose enough to do the samba. Okay? So the lower back needs to be released. And as your arms go down to your side, you feel the shoulder blades staying close together. So for most people, 2 to 4 inches apart is a good width for the shoulder blades. So in that position, when you take in a breath, your clavicle is not going to go up and down. Your shoulders are not going to go up and down. The shoulder blades are going to stay together. So I want you to take a breath and blow it out. Now take half of that breath and blow it out. Good. So we don't need maximum airflow for good singing. We need moderate. Moderate is best. So you need to not overdo it, because then you're going to start lifting your shoulders. So I want you to just hum for me a nice, easy descending scale. Now as we get higher, the singer wants to get excited. And suddenly she starts lifting her shoulders again, so we have to watch out for that. Let's go a little higher. Step. good, so let's use some vowels. Let's use yi, ye, ya, yo, you. Those five vowels. Yi first.
Ye,
ya, yo. Pretty good. Can you give me more dynamic variety from loud to soft in each of those? Let's go to step. Good. Now I want you to feel a little more vibration in the face on the Y. Try that. Now let's stay on the same pitch. I want you to be a little less loud, but more vibration in the face. That's the ringing resonant that's going to penetrate the back of the theater. Okay, thanks for cooperating. So now we're back on track, and we're going to go to a few of the generic problems that face a lot of the people. Broadway singers today are of every single genre. Broadway is not what Broadway used to be, so we need to now know, as pedagogues, every single genre to continue. Looking at country singers, sometimes they need just a little help getting through a rough patch because they want to sing like they talk. They also want to be humble. They also want to think that there's no big deal about them. But they have grueling tours and big stadium concerts, and it's not easy. Operatic superstars are facing much more difficulty these days because they have to do more difficult things all the time. They're doing crossovers into every other genre. I've seen opera singers doing rap concerts and other things too, and worse. So, as we begin to look at the demands on all of these singers, the wet mouth is so important. Lubrication of the voice is the most important thing that I can teach somebody that has a problem with their voice.
Most everybody's experienced momentary stage fright when you stand up in front of a PTA meeting and you have to speak publicly. And that bit of cotton mouth that you get, that dry mouth, is something that our singer has to face all the time. Stage fright?
Yeah.
You get sweaty palms?
Very sweaty.
Dry mouth?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, what do you think about dry mouth?
Just keep working it and try and get some saliva. If it's really bad, I will actually bite the end of my tongue a bit to get.
That's very important. We have a few tricks we use. One is to bite down the tip of the tongue just to the point of pain. The mouth will fill with saliva, and then when you swallow it, it's feeling good.
Very good. So as we look at these other genres, I want to pay special attention to screaming rock tenors. There are these kids that come in and they want to sound just like somebody else. One of my clients was the screaming rock tenor in the band AC/DC, but he had a special attribute. He had a lot of saliva in his mouth all the time, and he never hurt himself because he had so much lubrication. So I am going to warn all of you that if you don't have a natural propensity for lots of lubrication, you shouldn't try to sound like AC/DC. It takes talent. But one of the elements of talent is your own physiology. If you can produce a lot of saliva, then maybe you can be a Helen tenor. You can be a rock star. But it does take a lot of lubrication to get through this. So as we go on to these other genres, we're going to skip quickly through because we're on a red light now. And looking here at the end, different genres have lots of different requirements. Let's listen a little bit to the vocal variety elements in these voices. Expected to do things that are not so healthy for them. The when you listen to the lead singer, she's doing something very different.
Oh, I love you, a bushel and a peck, a bushel and a peck, and a hug around the neck, and a barrel and a heap, barrel and
you
a heap.
You hear the vocal variety she's using? She's avoiding injury, just using the variety. So as we go on, we need to look at what else we can do in vocal pedagogy. There are lots of meetings you can go to. PAVA is one of the new organizations, the World Voice Congress, the Pan-European Voice Congress has been around for a nice long period of time. And you'll see that there are several others that you can go to. I hope you will all take advantage of some of these opportunities. Thank you very much, and we have questions a little later. Very good, thank you very much.